Hey, good morning, everybody. This is the Clay Terrace Bible Study. I'm Neil Cox, just one of the neighbors in Clay Terrace, the neighborhood in Carmel, Indiana, north side suburb of Indianapolis. And again, our goal on this Bible study will just be a diverse study of the scriptures and from some different perspectives. And then, of course, try to sharpen one another with this so that we can understand God's message to us in black and white. That said, Pastor Andy Hunt is our lead pastor, comes from the New Life Community Church in Indianapolis, 86th and Ditch. And we have other pastors online from other places and chaplains and just regular folks like myself. So that said, Pastor Jim Wright, if you would lead us in prayer, then we're going to read the whole of Jude 3 today, Jude 3. So, Jim, if you would.
Okay, let's pray. Father, we just thank you for another day to live and to worship you. We thank you for your amazing love that we can never outrun. And Father, we thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit who teaches us. And we thank you for your word that you've given to us to learn about you and how you've dealt with humanity. And Father, we thank you for the freedom to gather here this morning and for the technology that we have that we can meet together even though we're scattered across the area. And Father, we do thank you for the reformers, and we thank you, Father, for that very important time in church history. And we just thank you for what they've done. And we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to learn about them this morning. And Father, we pray for the requests that have been mentioned that are on all of our hearts. And Father, we all have individual requests. And Father, we just want to pause right now for just a few moments and lift up those requests to you in our hearts. Hear our prayers. And Father, this morning we pray for the salvation of our relatives and friends and family members. And Lord, we pray that we'll be salt and light to them and share the gospel with them. We pray for our churches, Lord, that we will faithfully lead them as well as faithfully be a part of them. And we pray that you'll use us to reach out into this community and to the world. We pray for our nation, for our president, for our leaders, for this upcoming election, Lord. And Father, we just pray that your will be done. And Father, we pray that you'll guide Brother Andy as he teaches us this morning, that we learn from your word and that we're encouraged and strengthened and Father, rebuked when we need to be rebuked. We love you, Lord, and thank you for all that you've done. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right. And Chaplain Tony, if you'll read out of the book of Jude, it's only one chapter. So chapter 1 and verse 3 will be the theme today.
Okay, Jude 1 verse 3, and it reads, "Dear friends, although I was very eager to write to you about the salvation we share, I felt compelled to write and urge you to contend for the faith that was once for all entrusted to God's holy people."
Praise God. Amen. Amen. What translation is that, Chaplain?
That's the NIV.
Okay. I'm going to read from the ESV here. "Beloved, although I'm very eager to write to you about our common salvation, I found it necessary to write appealing to you to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints." You know, I think it's incredibly interesting here that Jude felt an urgent need to contend for the faith, and he took it as a priority over even the exalted and the empowering understanding of our common salvation. And if you want to isolate just those two words, the faith, I think it refers to the received body of truth at that time about Jesus Christ and about our salvation through him. which is just the word of God that has been once for all delivered to the saints. Jude is saying that this faith, this understanding of who Christ Jesus is, this understanding of how we receive salvation through Christ Jesus, through all of the apostolic teaching of the early church, could not be changed. So we're going to use this as a kind of theme as we go through and look at what's near and dear to my heart, and to many of us here, is a Protestant Reformation. You know, I'm amazed sometimes how many people don't recognize why we are Protestants. And even from the other side, from those who are in Catholicism that don't have a complete story or a very clear overview of what happened at that time. I mean, we find out in the 1600s that the faith that had been delivered to the saints was being attacked and it needed defense. And that defense comes in the Protestant Reformation. But if we can look at just three different questions this morning as we look at this, what was the Protestant Reformation? What did Protestants seek to accomplish with this? And thirdly, as Protestants, why we should always be reforming? Now, the Protestant Reformation is a widespread theological revolt that happened in Europe because of the abuses and the authoritarianism of the Roman Catholic Church. You've got reformers such as John Calvin in France and Ulrich Zwingli in Switzerland. And for me, the most notable one, Martin Luther in Germany. And they're protesting these unbiblical practices in the Catholic Church. They wanted the church to return to sound biblical doctrine. They wanted to contend for the faith. And we are simply Protestants because we did what? We protested. And Martin Luther's precipitating act that kicks all of this off happens October 31st in 1517 when he posts the 95 theses on the church door. And I know a lot of kids were asking me, oh, why would he post this on the church door? At this time, the church was so necessary, which it still is, and so vital, which it still is, in the lives of people, that posting something that important on the church door served like a global or more community bulletin board. And everybody would go by and see that and be able to understand the arguments of the day. So we recognize that the first thing we have to look at is probably the Catholic understanding of apostolic succession. Apostolic succession. This is the doctrine that Catholics hold, that there's a line that extends all the way back to Peter as the first pope, and that line extends all the way through all of the popes to today, and that this unbroken chain of authority makes the Roman Catholic Church the only true church. And everybody else is just a sister church at best, and it gives the Pope preeminence over all churches everywhere in their opinion. Now, because of this belief of apostolic succession, and the belief of the infallibility of the Pope, that he can never be wrong, especially when he's speaking in the full force of the office, simply means that Catholic teaching is placed on the same level as Scripture. Catholic teaching, tradition, and Scripture are all on the same level. And this is one of the major differences between us and Roman Catholics, because we only have one source of truth. And You know, there are people all through that time who were contending for the faith. John Wycliffe, English theologian, he was a professor at Oxford. He was condemned as a heretic in 1415. And then you have the same thing with John Huss, a priest from Bohemia that was burned at the stake and for his opposition against the church at Rome, against a false teaching. So it all came to a head as Martin Luther, which was a monk, a Catholic monk, challenged the authority of the Pope, in particular when it came to the selling of indulgences. So what's an indulgence? Catholic teaching speaks of the fact that if you have mortal sins and venial sins, and if you die with those sins unrecovered or unforgiven, then you spend time in a place called purgatory. And purgatory gives you a chance to be redeemed and justified from those sins, and then you proceed to heaven. Now, indulgences, you could purchase them from the church, and they would lessen your stay in purgatory. So you could get out of there and proceed on to heaven. And obviously, when you look at the scriptures, there's no indication of purgatory. And if you have purgatory, then honestly, why Christ? Because Christ takes away any need for purgatory. So we see here that Martin Luther was overwhelmed by the selling of these indulgences and other things that the Catholic Church had walked away from the true biblical teaching. Go ahead.
I heard a fairly young Catholic apologist the other day made an argument that purgatory is, well, rooted in 1 Corinthians 3, where our works are tried by fire. And he argued that everybody's going to have some sort of a purification process they go through anyways. And that's where that comes from. And, you know, didn't purgatory come from Origen and the Alexandrian school of thought? Okay. Mm-hmm. But anyways, I just found that curious. I had never thought of 1 Corinthians 3 as a purgatory type passage. So I don't believe in purgatory, but there is a sense and truth in that we all will have some sort of a purification, but not for salvation. I think that's maybe where he misses the boat.
Oh, altogether, yes.
Yeah. Anyways, I'm sorry to interrupt you.
Oh, no. We will be, we will be judged for those things that we have done, good or bad. But again, I think it's really a stretch, number one, to assign that to a place called purgatory, a further stretch that we could buy our way out of that. I think that's just amazing.
But it does make for good fundraising.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's why you have those beautiful cathedrals in Europe.
St. Peter's Basilica, wasn't that how they raised the money for it? Pope Leo X?
Exactly.
There you go.
I mean, it had it in, but I think it was fraught with fraud, but go ahead, Neil. Yeah.
Well, I was only gonna add, so we're talking about like Luther's day and so forth, which is in the 1600s, am I right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so up to that time, I would say one of the misconceptions may be that, oh, the Catholic Church existed from, right after Jesus went to the cross and was resurrected, went to heaven, right? And then the Catholic Church started, and it's been the Catholic Church all the way to the 1600s. But obviously, as Jim just started to point out, some of the early church fathers is kind of where it went off track. Could one of you or both of you rehearse the progression of how and when the Catholic Church as we know it started?
I think this question is in the same. When did the East and West Church split? That the East Church being Roman Catholic. Yeah. Andy,
I'm going to go with Jim. He's stopping at the bit. Go right ahead.
Dust off my church history here.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've always found it interesting, the Catholic Church, because to me, I guess if there's a starting point, it's around Constantine, when the church became formalized in Rome and became public, that at that point, the church really didn't, I mean, you know, you look at the New Testament, I think you had elders and you had bishops. But when you get into Constantine, suddenly all that becomes a formalized system. And I think that's really when you start seeing the Catholic Church, and then you don't really hear about it, but there's splinter groups that start breaking off that say, no, this isn't what we're going to do. So I think that would, I don't know, I think that would be about the start of the Catholic Church around the 300s, AD 400s. And then it just developed from there. I think the split happened, was it around 1100 or something like that? I can't remember. Between the East and the West. At one point, Holly, there were four popes running around. I think one of the splits was over iconography. The Eastern Church will not have statues. They will only allow paintings, 2D representations. They argue that statues that the Western Church has are basically idols. So that was one of them. The Eastern Church refused to accept the Bishop of Rome, who is the Pope, as the Pope of the Church. So the Eastern Church split off from them. The Eastern Church is not really at all influenced by Augustine, whereas the Western Church is heavily influenced by Augustine. So those are some of the differences I can think of right off the top of my head. They both build beautiful buildings sometimes, but okay, so, I think there's an Eastern Orthodox Church up there in Carmel that I've always wanted to go to, but I've never been in it.
It is gorgeous, Jim.
Yeah.
You know, it used to be down on what was almost around Kessler, because they used to have a Greek festival.
Yeah, I've always wanted to go to that.
Oh my God, it's beautiful. It is beautiful.
I do love gyros. They're very good.
I misspoke. The Western is Roman Catholic. I'm sorry.
Yeah, the Western's Roman Catholic. The Eastern's Eastern Orthodox.
Yeah.
Which okay, so
to Russia and all that area.
To the question or to the issue of apostolic succession, which again, so if you're saying, hey, this kind of really became prevalent in say 300, well, hey, there's at least a 200 year gap between the writings of the apostles as we know it, and as we discussed last week, like who's an apostle. What happened during that 200 years that this apostolic succession protocol or principle or whatever foundational tenet, it somehow came into being? That as we all know, like, oh, the first pope was Peter. But I'm like, okay, but in 300, how did they then start enumerating what that family tree of the papal authority was? Anybody want to talk about that?
Well, they consider the Bishop of Rome as the Pope. So they would probably go back and say who was the leader of the Roman Church after Peter, which they viewed as the leader of the Roman Church. So the Catholics argue that they go all the way back to Peter, just as the Baptists, well, not all Baptists, but landmark Baptists believe they go all the way back to John the Baptist, the original Baptist, which is funny. But that's probably what they did, was trace the bishopric from Peter Ford, whoever was the leader of the church at Rome. That would be my,
okay, how they do it. So what scriptures would they have turned to say, oh, okay, so yeah, as you said, whoever is the leader of the church at Rome, you apparently are a present day apostle. in the year, what, 100, 200,
right,
300? What scriptures are they leaning on?
Well, again, their view was whoever was the leader of the church at Rome is the bishop of Rome, hence the pope.
So a view without a scriptural base.
Well, Neil, that's the point. When you have tradition, what the pope says, and scripture all at the same level as determining what is biblical, then you can go anywhere with it. It's a wax nose. You can form it any way you want to, because you've got these three elements here instead of one element, which is scripture.
But
even if you go back to what they say about Peter, that comes out of the Caesarean confession. The confession is when he says, Jesus says, "Who do you say that I am?" And they take that when Peter answers, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus says, "Simon Bar-Jonah, Simon, son of Jonah, flesh and blood did not tell you that, but my Father who is in heaven." Jesus is saying that he is a pebble, Petros, and that the confession is the rock that he will build his church upon. So, whatever you want to, when you've got, you're juggling three balls, tradition, what the Pope says, and what scripture says.
Okay, but we do know scripture does say, right, that the temple, the metaphorical temple, that is us, the community of Christ, past, present, future, right, is built on Christ as the cornerstone, built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets. Am I right?
Yeah, on the apostolic teaching. The apostolic teaching is the foundation of the prophets and the apostles.
Yeah, okay. So somebody quick refer us to what verse that is, because I think it probably is going to just say the apostles and the prophets, which we see interpreted as the teachings of. And by the way, I would hold to that. That is the written black and white teachings of the apostles, either themselves as the authors guided by the Holy Spirit or affirming those who were guided, their hands were guided by the Holy Spirit. What verse, somebody? But then the real question was going to be, and what basis in scripture would they say, and the traditions of the body of Christ? So the traditions count equally with scripture. Is there any kind of verse that they lean on?
I don't know if there's a verse they lean on, but Catholics put tradition on the same level, sometimes probably higher than scripture. I would say, I think that's a danger you run into when you start allegorizing scripture, which is out of the Alexandrian school, Origen and folks like that, because then you can start really creating all sorts of things. Because what Jesus says with Peter is a play on words. Mm-hmm. As Protestants, we say our foundation is on the word. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. That's the rock. But Catholics say, well, when Jesus says you are Peter, they say, well, he makes Peter the rock, the foundation of the church. And so, And I would say, Neil, I mean, it's just like Jesus said, don't call anyone father, but what do Catholics want to be called? Father. Yeah. It's interesting that their first pope, Peter, was a married man, yet they, since the Middle Ages, have not allowed their clergy to get married, in rare cases. So it's kind of interesting that a lot of things are flipped.
Even that singular passage, about Peter the rock, foundation of the church, a handful of verses later is called, Peter's called Satan, right? I mean, hardly infallible, I guess would be my point there. But okay, so thank you for those clarifications. Andy, back to you.
Okay. Well, at the heart of the Protestant Reformation, I think lied four different questions. How is a person saved? Where does religious authority lie? what is the church and what is the essence of a Christian living? The reformers sought to answer those questions and more through what they call the five solas, a sola being a Latin word for alone. Now, these five solas are essential points, I believe, of biblical doctrine that separate Protestants from Roman Catholics. The first one, and again, for me, the most important one, I don't think, you know, in the ranking here, I think that's why it comes first, is sola scriptura, which is scripture alone. The Bible alone is the sole authority for all matters of faith and practice in the Church of Jesus Christ. Scripture and scripture alone is the standard for all teachings and traditions of the church that is used as a measuring rod. It's the, if it doesn't pass scripture or adhere to scripture, scripture interprets scripture, then it does not exist in the Church of Jesus Christ as a prohibition or as a way of, essential way of Christian living. Martin Luther was put on trial, you know, he was called a heretic. He was put on trial and he was asked to recant his teachings. And we remember the quote, "Unless I'm convinced by scripture or plain reason, I do not accept the authority of popes and councils, for they have contradicted one another. My conscience is kept captive to the word of God. I cannot and I will not recant anything, for to go against conscience is neither right or safe. God help me." And we see the second sola, sola gratia, salvation by grace alone. Salvation is proof of God's undeserved favor for us. We are rescued from God's wrath by his grace alone, not by any work we might perform. Ephesians 2, 8 through 10, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast, for we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." It's the blessing of God through Christ Jesus as being the sole affixion cause of salvation. The work of grace is a supernatural work of the Holy Spirit that brings us Christ by releasing us from our bondage of sin and raising us from spiritual death to spiritual life. Then we have sola fide, salvation by faith alone. We're justified by faith in Christ alone and not by the works of the law, because none of us can keep the law perfectly. It is by faith in Christ that his righteousness is imputed to us as the only possible satisfaction for God's perfect standard. Imputation, I think, is important, because if we are saved by works, and I can agree on one hand that we are saved by works, but we're saved by the works of Christ Jesus, not our own. It was Christ Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection that brings us salvation. We have a solus Christus, in Christ alone. Salvation is found in Jesus Christ, and no one or nothing else can save us. In Acts 4:12, it says this, "And there is salvation in no one else, for there is not any other name under heaven given among man by which we must be saved." It's the substitutionary death, all-sufficient death of Christ on the cross that gives us our justification and reconciliation to God. Is only through Christ Jesus and Christ alone. And then the last one, excuse me, soli Deo Gloria, for the glory of God alone. salvation is of God and has been accomplished by God for his glory alone. I think we miss the fact of how important God's glory is and how prominent it is throughout the Bible that Christ magnifies God. We magnify him in the way that we live, when we honor his authority, when we live and work and breathe for his glory. 1 Corinthians 10:31. So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God. And I would make the argument, I think Jim is absolutely right, when Constantine made Christianity the legal church. Whenever we see a great influx, when he made it legal to be a Christian, you see this influx of people that come in to the faith. They're not coming to the faith for the right reasons. Now, before it was a bad thing to be a Christian, now he makes it legal. It's a good thing to be a Christian. So people want to associate themselves with that. You get a flood of people who are non-converted. And when you let people into Christianity who have not been converted by Christ Jesus, they start to peel away at it. And that just brings in all kind of heresies and all kind of trouble. I think we see the same thing. I would, maybe I get in trouble. I would go as far as saying the same thing with Charles Finley. It's supposed to be, this great time of gathering and evangelism, but what did it really do? It diluted the truth of God's word. Anybody tells you like he's some shoe salesman, I can convert a person in 30 minutes or less. It's dealing on persuasion, or, when they went to the mourning bench and all of that. None of that helped Christianity. And that really goes to the last question, is why we should always be reforming. Simpler reformanda, we should always be reforming, because when we don't, and I think we're in a time of that right now, we start to try on our own to redefine, rebrand is what they're calling it now. We're going to rebrand Jesus. We're going to make Jesus more reputable and more reliable and more respectable by presenting this new and improved Jesus to this generation. Neil, if you can show that video now.
Yep, sure can.
This is the latest effort to reintroduce Jesus.
Whoops, this is the, by the way, the page that Jim put in the chat to give us some background on Luther. And now I've lost my ability to find that video. I think it's, hang on just a second.
While Neil is looking for that, I'm not sure, but before Constantine made Christianity, quote, legal, I think in a lot of churches, if you profess a faith in Christ, there was usually a gap before they would baptize you, because they wanted to see if you were true a believer. And then when Constantine legalized it, it was just all hands off. Anyways.
No, you're absolutely right.
Yeah. Ready to play?
Yeah, I'm ready.
The girl got pregnant. She was scared. Her parents thought her boyfriend was the father, but the baby wasn't his. He loved her, so he offered to raise the child with her. One evening, the water broke. There wasn't time to get help. He delivered the child, laid him in a manger.
Wow.
Yeah, we won't go on to John MacArthur.
I love John Jim's reaction. That's the reaction of a true Christian. How do you build the false equivalency of a child's birth
I know you
a sinful
know
act and compare it to the birth of the Son of God through the Holy Spirit. That's going to be on the Super Bowl this year. That is something that the Southern Baptists got involved in. They're saying 7 months now, but they're lying through their teeth. It was at least a year and a half ago when I went to Nashville and complained when I saw it. I saw it by mistake. And it had the logo of the SBC on. I go like, how, we never passed this. How in the heck did this ever get? And they said, well, it was done through NAM, North American Mission Board. And we go like, man, you got to take that down because that is going to ruin us. That's the most ridiculous thing I've ever seen in my life.
Mm-hmm.
And they did do it. They blew us off. And now, just a couple of weeks ago, you know, Kevin DeZell comes out apologizing for it with a letter. And then his executive committee says, well, we never endorsed it. And they're trying to get their way out of it now. But it's like, this is $100 million ad campaign. And when you looked at that website, it's about seven sponsors, the biggest being the SBC and then the United Methodist Church. So it's just like, who fund, you know, we had to be in that funding. We want to say we're not, but then again, this is NAM. So that's a different entity. We don't have any authority over that budget. But this is the way you're going to, it's about 12 commercials. Jesus was a radical. Jesus was a gang leader. You know, just all these different things. And you know, if this is trying to win people to Christ, just leave them out there. Because this is not Christ. Go ahead, Gina.
No, I mean, I was just going to say, I mean, when you're sharing the dollar amounts, I mean, that is not how God intended. I don't believe that. That's how God intended his tithing. You know, I mean, I would not want to spend tithing money on a campaign like that. You know, that's just, I don't, that is interesting. I'm still processing, like, what? Oh my gosh.
Jim, what were your initial thoughts? I love your reaction.
Well, it just kind of intimates that it was a normal physical relationship type of thing. And I mean, that's the big problem right there. I'd have to watch the ad again, but that's my initial thought, not knowing any background, not knowing it was supposed to be about Jesus. I mean, it leaves you thinking that he was conceived the normal way. And I was just doing a little Googling here, trying to find out, the SBC's involvement, because that's very disturbing to me, because I don't want our money to go fund things like this. So I think sometimes our desire to reintroduce Jesus, we just need to let Jesus be Jesus. I mean, if you like him, you know, if you want to follow him and repent and turn to him, if you're not, I'm sorry. I mean, I can't sit here and, you know, cover him with chocolate and trying to make everybody, you know, love Jesus. I mean, you follow him or you don't, you know. It's like I remind people at church, Jesus never ran after anybody saying, wait, come back. He didn't do that.
But we think evangelism is beckoning and bribing and making promises of wealth and longevity and a peaceful existence. Jesus tells you himself, I didn't come to bring peace, I came to bring the sword.
I think the allure, especially in American culture, and I fell into this trap, I think, in my early days of ministry. We got to get people in. We got to build a big church. You know, if you're a pastor, that's what you're paid to do. You know, you're the CEO. Fortunately, I think I've outgrown that. We just need to preach Jesus and let him do his work. And whether it's a big church you pastor or a small church, it doesn't matter, as long as you're faithful and you're loving those who God brings to you. And but I think in America, especially, we've adopted this pastor as a CEO, and as a CEO, you need to make sure you grow that church. And, you know, I grew up under the what's called the attractional model, And, and we had, I grew up in a mega church, an early mega church, and we constantly had big events and big crowds and stuff. People walked the aisle every single service. And I know there's a lot of people saved and there was a lot of lives changed, but there was a lot of people that made false professions through all that too. But I just think that's, we just need to let Jesus be Jesus. And that disturbs me greatly. I didn't know we were involved with that.
So, without really speaking too much to this particular video or a program or whatever, although I might find myself the minority voice, you think, okay, so today's theme is like, basically, why are we Protestant? And when Andy asked me on the phone earlier this week about, hey, we want to talk about Protestant, what is it that makes Protestantism? I told him initially, our ability to fracture into a million pieces. I'm sure Luther didn't want that to happen. He was just trying to help with the abuses of his day. But look what we've become. Because we are so fractured, we can talk about this particular video or the program, whatever it is, and largely have little impact to do much about it. Why? Because we are not united in Christ. Our neighbors would not say, oh, there's the church at Indianapolis that we refer to occasionally. It's laughable. So we have no ability for our leaders to come together and sanction anything. John wrote, the Apostle John wrote Revelation maybe 50 years after Christ had ascended, right? And still by that point, there were the church at Ephesus and the church at Laodicea and the church at this city and the church at that city. They were not yet fractured. And yet, a lot of the letters, we say sola scriptura, but then we don't really go by it, So sola scriptura would indicate, hey, there is one body of Christ. There's one group of elders in a city. There's one group of deacons to ensure justice operations. But we don't go by that. So, to a degree, Protestantism, has gone down a slippery slope into dividing over anything and everything. In today's polarization, it could be, I'm against CRT, or no, I'm against Christian nationalism, or I'm against this, or we're against way more stuff than we're for. We lack an ability to have a core message to our 2 million people here in Indianapolis, a core message of what is the gospel. And Jesus, he was born in a manger. Conceived by the Holy Spirit. But he gets us, okay. I get that. I like that part. He does get us. He knows us inside and out because he became incarnate in the world, and he lived and he healed and he spoke justice, power to the authorities of his day. And he died on our behalf and was risen again and ascended into heaven. And we're going to see him again someday, right? But do you think that's a core message that's well understood by our 2 million residents? And if it isn't, what has prevented us from having a clear message in our city?
I mean, it's clear to me, in my small opinion, is that you have to go, that's why you're always reforming. You have to go back to those clear doctrinal precedents, like the solas, and then adhere to them. And then with that, see, the core message has been formed years ago. It was the faith once for all delivered to the saints. And whenever we go away from that and try to innovate, we dilute the gospel and we become fractured. I agree that there is nothing, and I've said it hundreds of times, that we, and it gets me in trouble, we should almost be more cultish. You don't have Mormons rogue. You don't have people in Islam rogue. There's one core message, and we have to stick with that. And then again, when it comes to the law of attraction, you are attracted to Christ Jesus because you're drawn. And everything else that we do to attract people is a bad persuasion and leads us down the wrong path. We don't make Jesus into what we want, for what you want him to be, so that you might come to him. Every time we look in scripture that Jesus, you may say, what's in a name? Every time we look in scripture that Jesus changes a name of a person, he does it to change their identity. When he takes Abram, it means high father, and then he makes him Abraham, father of a multitude. He takes Sarai, and her name is princess, and then he takes her to Sarah, and she's the mother of nations. He takes Isaac, and his name means laughter because Sarah doubted the promise that God gave him. He takes Jacob and he makes him Israel. He takes Simon and he makes him Peter. And people will argue and say, hey, Jesus called Peter Simon many times. Yes, because he was acting like Simon and he wasn't acting like Peter, which was his new identity, the rock. Now, long ago and far away in a far off place called Atlanta, Georgia, there was a pastor of a local church who was a son of a pastor. And his name was Michael. And he had two sons and two daughters. One son was a child prodigy. He went to Morehouse University at 15, graduated at 19. He obtained his Master's of Divinity and his doctorate before he was 27 years old. And then he was ordained as a pastor. While waiting to go to a church, his father, Michael, had the opportunity to go to Germany. So he goes to Germany and he's there for 3 to 4 weeks and he has a chance to go to Wittenberg to be at the church that Martin Luther nailed the 95 Feast of 95 Complaints against the church. He's overwhelmed by the courage that it took to do that, how Martin Luther stood up during great trials and persecution and threat of death and hid away and took the scriptures and translated them into German so that regular people could read, because all the scriptures were in Latin, the Latin Vulgate, and most people were illiterate. And that's why you have these beautiful cathedrals with stained glass. They were like comic books so they could teach the stories to the people because they couldn't read. And he was just saying, this man of great bravery because of what Christ had placed in him. So he comes home. It's 1957, June 23rd. He rushes into his home and he looks in this little box of important papers and he finds a birth certificate. It's a birth certificate for the son who's a child prodigy. He takes a black pen and he strikes through his name, Michael. And he writes the name Martin Luther. And that becomes Martin Luther King. Martin Luther King was never named Martin Luther until he was 28 years old when his father returned from Germany. And that change of his name changed his identity. And really, when you think about it, our name has been changed. Even in this particular passage in Jude, it says the word beloved. The word is agapetos. And you will see it in all, not all, but in most of Paul's epistles when he addresses us. The word means beloved. The word means my favorite. The word means esteemed. The word means worthy of love. So Christ is saying to us that we are worthy of his love and that we need to contend for the faith once for all delivered to the saints. You know, fashion changes, but class never changes. you know, they were wearing Oxford shirts in 1930, and Oxford shirts are still in style because they're classic. Fashion changes. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. We don't need to upgrade Jesus. We don't need a Jesus 2.0. We just need to preach him, preach Christ and him crucified. Those y'all come. Those who want, they have made a decision. Those who are on the fence, when you a non-decision is a decision. But we need to move on. Because God's going to take care of his own. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Okay, so this started with Reformation Day and the theme of the Reformation, why are we Protestant, and so forth. And, okay, bring it into our neighborhood, okay? So it's Friday at Clay Terrace, Friday, October the 28th, if I'm correct, right? So the 31st is apparently Reformation Day. In addition to / Halloween, A, is there a connection? But then B, what? How then shall we live, Andy? How then shall we live on Monday or Sunday or Tuesday? What are the implications of all this to me today and my neighborhood?
I think we go out and we preach the gospel to the nations. We show the difference. There's nothing wrong with the word Catholic. It's a word Roman that modifies it. We make sure they know what we stand for and who we are in Christ Jesus. We assure them that even Martin Luther, I believe with all my heart, Martin Luther never wanted to leave the church. He wanted the church to reform itself, to be the church and to follow scripture. The church left him. In the words of that great theologian, Ronald Reagan. And we do that. And then, you know, Halloween, how in the world is Halloween the second most important holiday in this country next to Christmas? Celebrating disembodied spirits. You know, we have to come out from among them. We don't celebrate that. We don't try to change it to make it work in church. Trunk and treat. No treats. You want some candy? Just buy a bag. We don't get involved with it. There has to be a difference between us and them. And, you know, I don't understand why we don't want to make the distinctions. Because people, those who are looking, and I don't want to say that because scripture says no one seeks after God, but those potential associates are drawn. So we live a life that shows that we are part of the light of the world, and then they are drawn to what they see. And that before they open a Bible, they see a living Bible. They see a living stone, living epistles to be read. You know, I'm still always amazed at the diligence and the discipline of Muslims in their prayer life, knowing that their prayers don't go any higher than the ceiling because they're praying to someone who is not a God, but still, we see the incredible discipline. Where is our disciplines?
You know? Yeah. And any other, anybody else want to jump in and apply anything that we've talked today?
How shall
we live in our neighborhood?
Really like to say that video, that first picture of the woman sitting on is extremely offensive to me. I mean, I thought, what? We've got some kind of strange ad. That is what stood out the most of that video to me, how offensive that first picture was. That's supposed to be private, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I can't believe, you know, that a Christian or, yeah, would dare put that kind of picture, you know, and it's usually just right there, right from even before they said anything, you know, it's just hugely offensive.
Okay, I think Jim is chomping at the bit, but with this caveat, give him the last word and then pray us out, if you would, Pastor Jim.
Well, two things. Andy, I really quick researched it. It looked like NAM said they initially talked to that group, but they pulled out and didn't do any funding. That's what they're saying, but you have an inside track. So, I think the overall, though, my final argument would be, you know, we need to continue to contend for the faith. And I think in this day and age, more than any, now with social media and everything and just the assault against scripture, which we're seeing from all fronts, you know, we've got to contend for preach the word in season and out of season. And I think we're into the out of season phase. it's probably going to get worse. I hate to be a Debbie Downer, but I just don't see it changing until Christ returns, but I know other people don't feel that way. But we just need to be faithful to preach the word and to teach it and to live it. We need to live it out. So, and be very careful. Be very careful.
Great.
So,
pray for us, Jim.
All right, let's do that. Father, thank you for Brother Andy and his teaching, and I thank you for this discussion. I thank you for those who have gone before us, who have preached the word faithfully in season and out of season, many who paid for their with their lives. And Father, may we be willing to pay the ultimate price if it ever came to that. Father, I just pray that you will give us wisdom to navigate very troubling times. And Father, that we will just constantly keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, who is the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is now seated at the right hand of the Father. And we look forward to that day when we will see him face to face. And we pray, Maranatha, even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you all.